After we've been talking extensively about the potential of e-fuels as a solution for climate-neutral transportation, let's finally talk about how they are made. This video is going to be very chemistry-heavy, but I will do my best to try to explain everything in a way that allows everyone to follow along. Before we can talk about the actual synthesis process, we first need to talk about redox chemistry. Elements can have different oxidation states. The way you can think of this is that different atoms can carry different amounts of electrons. If an atom is carrying many electrons, we say it is reduced, and if an atom is carrying few electrons, we say it is oxidized. Also, if an atom receives new electrons, this is called a reduction reaction, while the opposite is called an oxidation reaction. Finally, if we transfer electrons from one atom into another one, this process incorporates both an oxidation and a reduction reaction, and the whole process is referred to as a redox reaction. Redox reactions can be used to store energy in some sort of fuel. The central element for this is oxygen. Oxygen has two major oxidation states, an oxidized or low electron state and a reduced or electron-rich state. What we need to do is invest energy from a renewable source to take away electrons from oxygen atoms and transfer them onto some other atom. This way, those other atoms will form some sort of fuel. Later, we can transfer electrons back onto oxygen, which will re-release the energy. This is the basic principle behind any sort of fuel. There are three elements that we want to take a look at: oxygen, hydrogen, and carbon. Oxygen is oxidized or low on electrons in the form of oxygen gas, while it is reduced in both water and CO2 molecules. Hydrogen is oxidized while in water or in hydrocarbons, but is reduced as hydrogen gas. Finally, carbon is oxidized in the form of CO2, but is reduced in the form of hydrocarbons. I also need to mention that the other two only have one level of electrons in their electron-rich state, but for carbon atoms, there are several different levels of how many electrons they can have. Before we move on to e-fuels, let's actually first look at hydrogen as a fuel. We invest energy to produce hydrogen and oxygen gas from water. The hydrogen is then stored in a vehicle. Finally, when the vehicle is powered, hydrogen and oxygen react to form water again. If we look at our table, we can see what is going on here. At the beginning, oxygen atoms are reduced. Then we invest energy to transfer electrons onto hydrogen atoms. Finally, by transferring them back into oxygen, that energy is released again. With e-fuels, the process is similar. We start with electron-rich oxygen atoms in water, then we transfer them onto carbon atoms, forming hydrocarbons and oxygen gas. During the combustion, electrons are transferred back and energy is released again. So the production of e-fuels is always a form of CO2 reduction. And just to clear up any potential misunderstandings, the term CO2 reduction doesn't mean a reduction as in reducing the amount of emissions. Reduction is a chemical term that refers to the process of transferring electrons onto carbon atoms. There are two main techniques to reduce carbon atoms: thermal and electrochemical. Thermal methods work as follows. First, we invest energy to produce hydrogen. The hydrogen and molecules with carbon are then brought into contact, and the temperature and pressure are increased to often several hundred degrees Celsius and many times atmospheric pressure. Under these reaction conditions, and with the help of metal surfaces as catalysts, the hydrogen will then, so to speak, deliver its electrons to the carbon atoms. Thermal techniques have the disadvantage that they typically require these relatively extreme reaction conditions, which often makes them inefficient and expensive. The second approach is electrochemical. Here, two electrodes are connected through a circuit, with water at the anode and molecules containing carbon at the cathode. We then invest energy by applying a voltage. This will cause electrons to be transferred from oxygen directly onto the carbon atoms. The advantage of this technique is that it doesn't require the extreme reaction conditions that thermal methods need, and that they are potentially more efficient. The disadvantage, however, is that electrochemical reactions, especially with carbon atoms, are very tricky to do. Many small nuances have to be just right to make such a setup behave in the desired way, and the scope of the potential reactions is smaller than the one of thermal techniques. But if well optimized, this approach has the potential to be a much more elegant solution. For e-fuels, we now have two distinct reaction pathways available. One pathway goes like this. First, CO2 is converted to carbon monoxide. This can be done with either of the two techniques. This only delivers a few electrons to the carbon atoms. The bulk of the electrons is transferred in a second step, known as the Fischer-Tropsch process. This is a thermal process and results in a mixture of different hydrocarbons. This mixture can be thought of as artificial crude oil, which can then be further processed to fuels that are very similar to regular gasoline, jet fuel, or diesel fuel. Most research regarding e-fuels focuses on this pathway. The problem, however, is that the majority of the electrons is transferred with a thermal technique, which makes this approach very inefficient. Also, the crude oil has to be processed, which adds additional complexity, and large parts of that mixture is actually made up of smaller molecules that aren't even useful as fuel. There is a second pathway that sadly doesn't receive too much attention, so I want to cover it in more detail. First, we electrochemically convert CO2 into small alcohols or aldehydes with at most 3 carbon atoms. Then we connect multiple of these smaller molecules together by forming new carbon-carbon bonds, creating larger molecules in the process. Some of these can then already be used as fuel, but we can also further connect these via functional groups containing oxygen. The advantage of this pathway is that electrons are transferred electrochemically. The challenge, however, is that it is difficult to pull off. There are 3 steps here. The third one is relatively easy, so we won't talk about this step. It's the first two where things start to get tricky. Before we take a closer look, let's quickly examine what molecules we are even working with here. This pathway works with alcohols and aldehydes, which are partially oxidized molecules. Remember, carbon atoms have multiple levels of how many electrons they can be carrying. A pure alkane, which is a molecule that is solely made up of carbon and hydrogen atoms with no double or triple bonds, is reduced to the maximum extent, meaning these carbon atoms carry the most electrons possible. This is the type of molecule that makes up the largest parts of oil-based fuels. Below that are alcohols. Carbon atoms that have an alcohol group attached are slightly less reduced. That's why these substances have slightly lower energy densities. The difference becomes less pronounced the longer the chain gets. For example, butanol, which is a 4 carbon atom alcohol, has better energy densities than ethanol with its 2 carbon atoms, which itself is more energy dense than methanol with 1 carbon atom. The energy density of butanol and larger alcohols is not much lower than the one of oil-based fuels, and we will soon see that many of these actually also have some advantages over oil-based fuels, mainly superior combustion characteristics. And finally, below alcohols are aldehydes, which carry even less electrons. There are many other types of molecules and other oxidation stages, but we won't cover them here. So, during the first step, we can produce alcohols or aldehydes with either 1, 2, or 3 carbon atoms. The rule here is that larger molecules are more difficult to produce. During the second step, we can connect 2 of these, but we could also attempt to connect 3 or more. But here too, the rule is the greater the number, the harder it becomes. For higher energy densities and other fuel characteristics, however, we want large molecules. This puts us in a position where we need to carefully choose a pathway that is reasonably easy to execute while also resulting in reasonably large molecules. After looking into this for quite some time, the choice that I think makes probably the most sense is to go with 2 carbon molecules during the first step and connect 2 of them together during the second one. Specifically, we want to produce ethanol and connect 2 of these molecules to form butanol. There is, however, a small problem. Two ethanol molecules carry exactly the right amount of electrons to form one butanol molecule. The problem is the molecules are connected via a mechanism called aldol reaction, and this only works with acetaldehyde. This is the aldehyde equivalent of ethanol. It's essentially an ethanol molecule with two fewer electrons. By connecting two of them, we will not get butanol, but croton aldehyde, which lacks a total of four electrons. There are multiple approaches on how we can tackle this. One way is to start with acetaldehyde during the first step and use thermal methods to deliver the missing electrons later. This could actually make sense since hydrogen gas is often an unwanted byproduct of the first step, which would now serve a useful role. Another approach is to start with ethanol during the first step and use a certain type of catalyst known as a borrowed hydrogen catalyst. It works by taking electrons away from two ethanol molecules, connecting them together, and finally giving the electrons back. Yet another pathway is to start with ethanol, but then use it as a reduction agent to reduce croton aldehyde that has already been produced. This will turn ethanol into acetaldehyde, so these molecules can then themselves be connected, and the process starts over. So after these steps, we will arrive at butanol, specifically 1-butanol, which is suitable as fuel in gasoline engines. We can also produce isobutanol, which is made up of the same number of different atoms, just connected in a different way. The process here is very similar. The only difference is that rather than combining two ethanol molecules, we combine one ethanol and two methanol molecules. These two isomers of butanol have slightly different properties, and for use as fuel, it likely makes sense to use a mixture of both. For diesel engines and aviation fuel, we can further combine butanol with formaldehyde to form butylol or dibutoxymethane. We can also combine butanol with its carboxylic acid to form butyl butyrate. A mixture of these two components, as well as small amounts of butanol, can then serve as fuel for these applications. Let's look at some characteristics of butanol and compare it to gasoline. As already mentioned, alcohols like butanol have slightly lower energy densities, but it's not a huge difference, and butanol does also have some advantages over gasoline. The octane ratings of 1-butanol are similar to those of gasoline, while isobutanol is slightly more knock-resistant. 1-butanol does also have a higher laminar flame speed. Butanol is also biodegradable. When it comes to emissions of particulate matter, nitrogen oxides, and unburned hydrocarbons, there is conflicting data from different sources, but overall the trend points towards butanol burning as clean or even cleaner than gasoline. This is a trend that can generally be seen with fuels that are made up of slightly smaller molecules and molecules that also contain oxygen. Since oxygen atoms are already present in the molecule and there are fewer carbon-carbon bonds, the likelihood of a complete combustion is higher, because a complete combustion occurs when all carbon-carbon bonds are split and all carbon atoms combine with oxygen to form CO2. You might wonder, can we just use ethanol directly? Ethanol has a few disadvantages. It's less energy dense, it's corrosive, and easily mixes with water. By contrast, because of its longer chain, butanol is generally more similar to gasoline than ethanol is. It has a more non-polar nature and thus doesn't easily mix with water. Its stoichiometric air-fuel ratio is much closer to that of gasoline, and it is not corrosive and works with existing infrastructure. It does have a few small disadvantages though. It is more viscous than gasoline and has a higher heat of vaporization, which means that the engine has worse cold start behavior. Now let's talk about diesel engines and aviation fuel. I want to focus mainly on butylol here. Butylol has excellent properties as fuel. Its energy density is almost identical to that of butanol. It has a high flash point and low autoignition temperature. In diesel engines, it was shown that when blended with regular diesel fuel, it significantly reduces particulate matter emissions. But an engine can also run on pure butylol, at which point soot formation is so low that it is virtually undetectable. At the same time, nitrogen oxide emissions aren't really affected by this fuel, which eliminates the conflict between optimization for low particulate matter or low nitrogen oxides that we usually have with diesel engines. Butyl has a much lower viscosity, which leads to better atomization. Also, the ignition delay is shorter because it has a high cetane number of approximately 74. Therefore, butyl shows a much smoother and quieter combustion. It is also biodegradable. However, pure butyl lacks lubricity and the viscosity is so low that it can actually lead to problems with the fuel system. Therefore, butyl can serve as the main component in the fuel, but has to be mixed with other components like lubricity improvers or the other two fuels, butyl butyrate and butanol, which can also be used to affect different fuel properties. These other two have also been studied for aviation. Butyl itself hasn't yet been considered for this application, but it alongside the other two shows those fuel characteristics that are important in aviation, like high flash point, low viscosity, and high energy density. Compared to regular jet fuel, they have just a little over 80% of the energy content and are between 1 and 8% heavier. If we look at existing aircraft designs, this means that these fuels allow for roughly 80% of the range and almost the same payload, which is still much better performance than the hydrogen-powered planes that Airbus is currently developing. Finally, there are two more things I need to mention. E-fuels rely on CO2 captured from the atmosphere, but I have never actually explained how this works. I won't go into too much detail about this process because this is not the focus of this video. What you're seeing here is a direct air capture facility. In short, the process works as follows. Large fans pull in air, which is then brought in contact with a solution of potassium hydroxide, which will absorb CO2. Subsequent chemical processes will then release pure CO2, which will also restore the original capture solution, so the process can start over. With our CO2 captured from the atmosphere, we can then proceed to turn it into fuel. The other thing I need to mention is the water supply. The production of e-fuels requires large amounts of water. This, however, is also true for the production of hydrogen, and lithium mines that extract lithium for batteries need large amounts of water as well. So every approach needs large quantities. Therefore, we need to think about environmentally friendly ways to supply water. Using groundwater in places like the Australian outback is a bad idea since this water source is very limited and exploiting it will pretty much inevitably have a lasting impact on the environment. One potential solution is to try to optimize the production of e-fuels in such a way that it can use seawater instead of fresh water. But these chemical processes are usually very sensitive to the presence of ions and impurities, and it's highly unlikely that it can be done without fresh water. Therefore, we need to use desalination plants at the coast. The water is then pumped inland through large pipelines, where it is used to produce e-fuels. The fuels are then pumped back to the coast from where they are transported with tanker ships. You might say, wait, didn't you say in the previous video that pipelines are a bad idea and that one of the advantages of e-fuels is that they don't need any of those? The difference is, here we are talking about a small number of large pipelines along one or two paths. The problem with pipelines that I mentioned in the previous video is with highly branched networks of many small connections that create a dense network that covers a large area. This is very different from the situation here. If you remember, the energy source rule tells us that the reason why e-fuels are climate neutral is that they rely on renewable energy. It is possible to mix e-fuels with petroleum-based fuels. This likely can help with certain fuel characteristics and make the fuel more compatible with already existing engines. The problem with this, however, is the portion that is made up of fossil fuels will still create emissions. The amount of emissions will be lower, but our ultimate goal should be to use 100% e-fuels rather than a mixture. So from the very beginning, I suggest we stay away from the idea of mixing these two and focus on using 100% e-fuels instead. And this concludes my series about e-fuels. Feel free to ask questions. I would be very grateful if you could share these videos, because e-fuels is a technology that really deserves more attention and needs to be researched more. Thanks for watching!